with about Faghmieda's attitude. After a while, I knew that was something wrong, and every time I asked her, she didn't answer me. I went to pray, me and my husband, asked God for help and give us guidance, what must we do and what have you. But one thing we told Faghmieda, through thick and thin we stand by her. Somebody told us you need counseling. But unfortunately, there was no counseling for Muslim people. I admire Faghmieda. Is when she started to fight with the imams at the masjid. And she won. I can't recall if there was anything bad happening after Faghmieda came out. Okay, there was one or two convents and so on, everything, but one lady that phoned to told me they must stone me and my daughter. We don't deserve to live. I said to her, you know what? Make dua for you, that if something like this mustn't happen to you or your daughter or one of your children.
If my mom says it wasn't, it was for them. I looked around my dad, it was not that easy.
Yeah, and but we had to be strong for Faghmieda, me and your father.
So my mom and dad had been her backbone. And then they also made the movie about her called Malawian Kiss. So it's like things unfolded. So my mom, of course, I think my mom is a hero because she lives with her every day. And until today, my mom takes care of Faghmieda. And that's for Faghmieda. Faghmieda has always been a very quiet girl in that sense. So she was, but I think it gave her the strength when she realized that she has some time that she can live with this, and she really understood what will happen to her body when she was more empowered. She realized that she could play a role. And together with some other members that was part of the group Positive Muslims, got together and established an organization called Positively Muslim. The challenge is for us as Muslim community to accept that yes, we are part of the world. We're part of the broader world. What affects somebody else affects us as well. We're not unique, we're not excluded. God doesn't exclude us because we're Muslim. I think things have changed. There are greater awareness now. We are so fortunate we have social media, and I think that has really brought a lot of instant change globally. We fight each other as if we are enemies, and yet we're all part of the same global, universal community where they're just the only thing that unites us is love and care. So
I got married at the age of 26, and I got married to a foreigner. And at that time in South Africa especially, people didn't talk about HIV and AIDS at all. I myself, I didn't know much about it. The only thing that I knew was if you have AIDS, you're going to die, like immediately. I moved with my late husband to his country, and after 7 months of marriage, he passed away. He died in my arms. I didn't know what he died of. I was alone. I was scared. And the doctor just told me that he had a heart attack. But I also remember before he died that he had tuberculosis and he lost a lot of weight. And in fact, I myself was basically experiencing the same type of symptoms. And but you know, I'm not a medical expert. I just believe what the doctor said. So after the funeral, about 1 month after that, I became more sick. I lost more weight. And when I called my parents, they were like very worried. They said I should come back home. So after exactly 1 month after my husband passed away, I came back to South Africa. And that is where it all basically started. When I arrived here, my parents took me to our local GP. I was laying there, you know, one of the doctors asked me like very casually, have you been for the AIDS test? Now imagine, you know, I'm sick, I don't know what's wrong with me, and someone still asked me this question. You know, I was like, I really felt insulted. AIDS was for someone that was either homosexual at that time, that was what people needed to believe, or you must have been, you know, a loose type of woman. You know, you had no morals at all. But I was a married woman, so how can you ask me something like that? But while I was standing there, she came in. into the room where you, in the waiting room. And as I turned around, you know, she looked at me and I looked at her, and she started to cry. And for me, I then knew that I had AIDS. I gave away some of my most precious belongings, like my teddy bears, because I used to love teddy bears. And my mom was like, what is wrong with you? Why are you doing this? So I just said, no, I'm starting a new life. But I basically prepared myself to die. I still had a lot of anger inside of me because I still haven't like come to terms with the fact that I was now infected with AIDS. And because, like I said, at that time, the community made me believe that it was a bala, it was a curse from Allah. So that is why I kept quiet. I couldn't talk to anyone in my own community or even in my own family about it. And learning how I can really continue with my life as a person living with HIV. So, but the doctor did warn me that there's no space for Muslim people, and that the counselor is a very staunch Christian lady. And I said to her, you know what, I do not care what faith or what religion this person is from. All I wanted to know was, how do I survive? But nevertheless, I then joined the Christian support group, and I must be honest with you, they were very, very supportive. They really opened up their hearts and their arms for me. And from them, I have learned that AIDS was not a curse from God. It can happen to anyone. And I felt safe in that group, but I also felt a bit lonely because I couldn't talk to them about Islam. You know, my question was, what does Islam say about people living with HIV? What does the Quran say? And then I said to Sophia one day, you know what, I'm tired of hiding. I'm tired of having to lie to my family. And I feel that I want to disclose to them. And she said to me, you know what, Faghmieda, you must realize that your family, as much as they love you, they might either reject you or they might accept you. You know, it's a gamble that you will have to take. What I noticed was, you know, when I disclosed to the family, some of them were very distant towards me. And I remember there was a period where some of the family members did not come to our house anymore. And I think all those things made me more determined to speak more about HIV. And also it made me more determined to start my own organization. And but even today, there are still a few family members that do not speak to me because of my HIV status. But you know, I'm at that point in my life where, you know, that's your issue.